So first up will be Dr. Simon Barguera. He's based in Mexico City. He's trained both as a surgeon and in nutrition science at the Friedman School at Tufts University. He has consulted for the World Bank, but nobody's perfect. Also, the World Health Organization, the Pan American Health Organization, the Food and Agricultural Organization, UNICEF. And the reason he's in such demand is because of his extensive work in nutrition, diabetes, and chronic disease research. He's the author of over 100 peer-reviewed research articles, diverse books, and scientific papers, and he's currently the president of the Nutrition Board of Professors at the Mexican School of Public Health, among many other prestigious positions, and we're honored to have him here.
A pleasure to be here. Thank you for the invitation and the opportunity to share our experience in Mexico for the Mexican soil tax. So the next one. I want to start by sharing you this slide. This is one of the first articles I published in 2003, and this is the diabetes prevalence in Mexico compared with the US. And it took me a lot of time to convince the reviewers of accepting this publication, because they were not able to believe the slope of the trend of diabetes increase in Mexico, and then the huge difference with the US, which at that time was famous for the big prevalence of obesity and chronic disease. And in Mexico, they were very concerned about undernutrition and nutrient deficiencies. So they were not perceiving this as a big problem. So it took me a lot of time. We have external group reviewing this information. And as you can see, the last 2 points, that is 99 and 2000, are way up above the trend. I had to do a special modification of the trend, because if not, the line will look even steeper than it is. So this is one of the first things I was involved when I returned to Mexico after my graduate studies. The next one, please. Right after that, I was involved in different national nutrition and health and nutrition surveys. So the 1988 survey, that is the first one you see, the higher one, is when most of the Mexicans had a normal weight, and I was not in Mexico when this information was collected, but in 1999 I was the one in charge of analyzing body mass index in women, because we didn't have enough funding to analyze also men. So I showed this prevalence in which most of the adults were now above 50% in overweight or obese. Again, it was very hard to convince the authorities about the accuracy of these findings, so they reviewed this again and again, and then it was, they were starting to realize that it was a big problem in Mexico. As you can see there, in 2000 and 2012, still the distribution of the body mass index remained increasing. So right now, 70% of the population, the adult population in Mexico, has obesity or overweight. And you see here in the arrows first, in the first arrow, the US, and in the second, Mexico. But these are mostly countries in Latin America. And as you can see, all of them are above 50% obesity or overweight. So this is a very common problem in all Latin America. And it's very recent that you can, as you saw from the previous slide, maybe late 80s and in the 90s, we had this huge increase, and countries like Colombia are starting to increase the obesity prevalence with the speed we had 10 years ago. So this is another thing we tried to do once we realized that chronic disease were increasing very, very rapidly in Mexico. So we started to just to try to see what was happening with available sources of information. So this is the household food expenditure surveys, and this was another analysis we made from 1986 to 1998, and this was published in 2002, so this is 12 years ago. And we realized that soda purchases at the household level were increasing almost 40%, which is the blue bar, and fruits and vegetables in the same period decreased about 30%, which is the red bar. So we started to show this to policy makers and to authorities, but there was, in reality, only this like anecdotic or ecological evidence, not the association with the chronic disease. So they were very skeptical about this kind of finding. So we try to promote some initiatives and some ways to incentive reduction of sugar sweetened beverage consumption, but we were not very effective.
The next one, please.
By 2009, we created a task force to study and develop a national policy to prevent obesity by request of the Ministry of Health in our National Institute of Public Health. So we start to review lots of international contributions and studies about the effects of sugar, of soda. So I can tell you we review a lot of information of Dr. Augustin that is here and many other authors in the US that prove evidence. And sometimes the critique was, well, this is US, but this is not Mexico, or when we show information about Mexico, they say, well, but this is your idea, this is not in the rest of the world. So it was very complicated to try to develop this policy plan.
The next one, please.
And one of the things we identified in the rest of the world is that they were discussing some drivers of this epidemic, such as the nutrition transition in which that we are facing in the country, which there is now a very high availability of low-cost junk food, a very high sodium, fat, and sugar, and also a very high availability of sugar-sweetened beverage. So this was a constant in all of our research. So you can see here the water is in the floor, so it doesn't even have right to be in the... And also the problem of the tap water that was not safe enough to promote it in some places in the country, so it's a double challenge. So we also published the contribution of energy to the sugar sweetened beverage to the total energy consumption in Mexico, and as you can see here, it's about 20%. So we were happy with this finding because there was a similar study in the US in which this was more or less the percentage, so nobody told us this time we don't believe you. So it was more or less what is observed in other countries. So as you can see, even from 12 to 18 years, the consumption is about 350 calories from sugar sweetened beverage. And as you may know, this is not a natural way to have energy in our diet. The next one. And there are also many international studies and meta-analyses started to appear in which it was clear that sugar sweetened beverage consumption increased the risk of diabetes mellitus. So this was also very useful for us to show to decision makers and to health directors and health promoters to see that this was not only like an ecological observation now, but also in some prospective studies or cohorts, this was starting to be documented. The next one. So we ended up developing this national plan to prevent obesity, in which we have 10 objectives that are very common in most national plans, like reducing sugar, fat, and sodium, increasing water consumption, improving nutritional information, breastfeeding, etc. So one of those was to improve information about sources of hydration. The next one, please. And we developed this healthy beverage jar that is like the companion to the healthy nutrition plate. Our food pyramid is a healthy nutrition plate. So we started promoting that, and we made thousands of posters, and we were going to do a big campaign with the Ministry of Health. But the industry was very opposed to this communication. It had received support of all the nutrition societies, but the Ministry of Health discontinued the distribution to avoid conflict with the industry because they were reacting very, very strongly against it. Also, they had complaints about distributing this information, so this initiative was killed. However, right now, this it remained, I guess they just didn't notice, but this remained in the textbooks in primary schools. So this, I think, is in a way a success for health policy, because now all the the children in every year, in the first 6 years of primary school, when they review the healthy plate, they also review the healthy beverage recommendations. However, as you know, this is not enough when they are competing against millions of dollars of marketing on TV. So this is a success, but we realized it was not going to be enough. We remain documenting the trends of soda consumption. So this is just this year, 2014, and most of the categories of sugar, sweetened beverage in Mexico for school-age children and women are increasing, even using the same methods and with refined analysis. So every time we make a more complex analysis, we just confirm what we were observing since 2002. And also we were reviewing the options, the policy options, and we realized from this paper this cost per person per year for different policy options that were effective in different papers. So as you can see here, that interventions are a great opportunity because it's a very low cost and they are cost effective. And you see the next row is medical counseling, which is very effective, but it costs much more than a tax. So this was one of the things that made us think about the possibility of having this tax. The next one. Also, in 2008, we just as an exercise, we tried the elasticity of a tax of 10% over the consumption of sugar sweetened beverage in Mexico. And as you can see, the first three bars, in this exercise, we did it with changing consumption per milliliter. So now we are doing it by calories, but at that time it was milliliters, and we saw a reduction. And also, as you can see, the different colors of the bars are different income in third tax. So not very different. So it affects the same poor and rich people in the country. This is one of the last things we have been doing, a random control trial in which we replaced water to women that were drinking lots of calories of soda or sugar sweetened beverage. And after almost a year of supplying water and obviously also nutrition recommendation, we proved that obese women had a reduction in plasma triglycerides and metabolic syndrome prevalence. So this is one of the latest evidence that critics were asking. Can you prove in an intervention that replacing water will have these benefits? And at least we were able to document this effect. The next one, please. So for the initiative, and Rebecca is going to talk much more about the process, but we prepared this table in which we had the potential benefits of having a 10% and a 20% soda tax in Mexico. So just to mention some of the main, the tax effect, 10%, we were expecting a reduction of 10 to 30% in sugar sweetened beverage, but also a reduction in consumption per person per year, assuming that the Mexicans have 163 liters per year of sugar sweetened beverage, of 70 to 22 liters. So for those that were criticizing this tax, saying, well, this is going to be only 1 point of body mass index. Well, is imagine 22 liters of sugar sweetened beverage per capita for 100 million inhabitants. It's a huge effect in public health. And this was, we also were expecting 400 to 630,000 less diabetes mellitus cases, so that, prevented cases, and a revenues of around $1,185 to $1,231 million. So this is what we were prepared as a potential effects of soda consumption. The next one. And the nice thing that have been happening in Mexico is the NGOs rise in this process, and they were instrumental and critical to push this soda and to modify public opinion. So you can see many of them, and one of the key players is Poder, El Consumidor, that was one of the main opinion communicators and also translators of this information to decision makers. And also but this was sponsored by all these companies. And you can see the main companies in the world, like PepsiCo, Coke, Danone, Sigma, Unilever, Nestle, and all of them sponsoring this webpage and making a lot of messages that were confusing opinion and also counter-attacking the messages from NGOs. Some of the nice things that we were able to see that were very helpful were support from international organizations, academia, and NGOs. So this is a wonderful effort. This is a letter from the International Obesity Task Force. And we were working, many people from academia were working on the letter and discussing it with different leaders from the International Obesity Task Force. And then the NGOs, La Alianza, was able to get funding to publish this open letter in a newspaper, maybe like 2 days before the voting of the initiative. So it was very powerful because they were saying, oh, this is a national initiative. It doesn't have international support. So that was a very good piece in the network. Also the WHO making this communication saying that could be beneficial for Mexico, that was very powerful because then it was even supported by international organizations. And the NGOs were smart enough to have this fight side by side with a big brand like Coke, and I have never seen this in any other part. I think this we need to recognize that they were very, very smart and able to compete with less funding, but very effectively. So all the people was aware about this debate. And the Big Soda obviously reacted, so we have this kind of pages in all the newspapers saying that soda hydrates provides energy and empty calories and a substantiated concept, but that is not scientifically justified in this moment. And then we have a lot of challenges now. For example, the soda is banned from schools, but there are a lot of these kind of juices for kids that are very high in energy. And also very high portion sizes. So this is a 10-liter sugar sweetened beverage that has oranges in the label and that says that has vitamin and that costs at less than $3. And the vulnerable population perceive this as a healthy beverage and they are buying this at a cheaper price than water. So this is a real problem. You can see inside there is an advertisement of chocolate for kids and it's just very down so they can see it. So this is the kind of problem we are facing in this one. And also this kind of very common scene in Mexico where the soda are the sponsors of the food section in the supermarkets and they offer special promotions. So sometimes people going to buy the fruits, they just see the promotion and choose the promotion. And then now there are appearing new players that are supporting soda that were not in the beginning, but now they have organized. So we have the soda producers, and they are giving scholarships to kids that are successful, and they are publishing big advertisement. Yesterday there was one in the sports newspaper of the team, the Mexican team of synchronized swimming. And they were saying a little bit of sugar is great. So this is, we are also very concerned about these responses. The next one. So the preliminary evaluation, and I am almost finishing with this, is we have some results. It was 1 peso per liter, and it was an inside stats, and it started in January 2014. I'm sorry. This stat applies to non-dairy, non-alcoholic beverage without sugar. And we have data right now from a commercial panel of consumers. And the results that, this is very preliminary, but has been submitted to a very important journal, is that we observed a 10% decline in purchases of tax-exempt beverage in the first quarter compared to 2014 compared to 2013. So we are very happy to see that this is a very strong piece of evidence that nobody has and that will be very strong to support additional measures. Also, we observe a 7% increase in purchases of tax beverage, such as diet sodas, sparkling water, distilled water. And then, within this category, approximately 13% increase in plain water purchases during the same time frame. So, very important. This is one of the proofs that we need to show that the test is working.
The next one, please.
So I have six conclusions. The first one is that government actions such as regulation of advertising, labeling, food composition, as well as soda sweetened beverage and junk food taxes are really powerful tools to support healthy lifestyles. Also, that the soda tax in Mexico was possible thanks to the participation of many sectors. We really have before NGOs, but this time they were a big player. Also, we have very good national evidence, great international evidence appearing because this was a very good topic. So, all of that help and also opinions from international organizations. And then, although the amount of taxation approved was only 10%, researchers are finding preliminary positive effects, as I showed you in the next one. And the soda tax debate, as you hear previously, it has a very positive educational effect on consumers. So we think it's great to have this initiative in Berkeley, and the good effect is starting just by having these banners and watching people discuss about this problem. So this is great. And we also need to recognize that the federal government supported this alternative in search of fiscal reforms because they needed the revenue. So we have support from the government, and what we need now to do, and this is a challenge, is to follow up on the investments to improve access to water and promote its consumption, other healthy lifestyles. And finally, soda tax is only a component of a wider set of policy actions needed to support healthy lifestyles and reduce obesity and other non-communicable chronic diseases. So many times the critique is, this is not going to solve the problem of obesity, and we say, obviously not. So this is only a very important factor. So, the next one. So, I want to conclude with this line, and this is one of the campaigns at schools with children now bringing their bowl to drink water. Many schools in Mexico don't have potable water, but they bring water in containers, and they all have their glass, and we are trying to promote this a lot. The next one, please. Thank you very much.